draw the meeting to order, please. Can I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. Welcome to members of the public. Before going into the main business, just as usual, a few housekeeping points I want to mention. Can I remind everybody that all mobile phones should be turned to silent for the duration of the meeting, and to ensure everybody in the chamber can hear the debate, can I please ask members and people presenting reports to use the microphones and to speak into them, please. So they work best when they're close to you. And as usual, the meeting will be filmed this morning by officers from the Combined Authority and will be available on the Merseytravel Council YouTube channel later today. So those are the housekeeping points. So into the main business. Item one is apologies for absence. Okay, welcome to those members. Item two are the declarations of interest. Okay, thank you. Item three is the minutes of the last meeting of the Combined Authority held on the 7th of July. Can I ask, are these approved as a correct record of that meeting? Agreed. Thank you very much. Okay, on to item four, the potential devolution of powers and funding to the Liverpool City Region. I'm going to ask Jed Fitzgerald to do a presentation on this, just to introduce the item, if you wouldn't mind, Jed. Thank you.
The principle of devolution was strongly affirmed, and actually they've sought actively to accelerate the process and progress of devolution up and down the country and in the local government world, particularly and possibly also in the business community up and down the land. There's a lot of conversation going on around this exact issue, a lot of consideration being given to the extent of devolution in terms of what's been sought from government. Are subsequently to both engage but also to pass on and agree to pass on devolution to the city region. The Queen's speech, as you know, announced the intention to develop legislation to support devolution, the draft cities and local government devolution bill. I wouldn't say that one too often this morning. It's working its way through the Houses of Parliament at the moment. Obviously, Parliament is on holiday at the minute, but when it comes back again, further detail around that will start to emerge, and we expect that to emerge in its final formal sense, possibly either side of Christmas. So it's important to bear in mind that whatever conversation conversations we have from this point going forward need to be referenced according to what is going to be in the legislation, because clearly everything that we do has to have a legislative basis. I know that sounds very boring and sounds very legalese, but it's actually very important. And that framework will obviously only emerge, as I say, over the autumn and possibly into the springtime of next year. That will provide the framework for the devolution of powers to city regions like Liverpool. There are a number up and down the country that are actively exploring devolution in the same way that we are at the moment. And the detail of those things will also emerge, I think, over the autumn here in particular. The last reference, obviously, is very simply said, but has a number of connotations associated with it. I think the government has said publicly, but hasn't said in the legislation so far, that its preferred governance model would be an elected mayor. So we have to have that, bear that in mind in terms of the context for the devolution conversations that we're engaging in. And the simplest way, Chair, when we say so, of thinking around this issue is around the price in terms of what we might be able to negotiate with government in terms of devolution to the city region, and recognising that there may be a price to be paid in the form of a change of government around elected mayors if the government persist position that they've taken so far around that kind of issue, but clearly massive amounts of detail before we get to that kind of level of analysis around whether any deal is worth any deal of the price is worth the price to be paid. Just to recap on the emergency budget that was in place on the 8th of July, seems quite a long time ago now for anyone who's involved in some of the ripples around this set of issues, but the devolution deal, potential devolution deal for the city region was referenced in the budget on that date. Since that time, we've been looking at, as officials, and trying to scope some of this out and start the kind of dialogue with senior politicians, obviously in the required authority sense, and trying to parallel that practically, and I emphasise the practicality of that, with colleagues in other agencies and organisations, with civil servants and so on. You can imagine a very complex set of issues this at the moment. And it is in very, very, very early stages of development, which is a point that I would also wish to echo at the moment. Just a reference that we know Leeds and Sheffield City regions were also prioritised in the statement in the budget. Following the budget's announcement on the 8th of July, we also understand that the North East is trying to get into the frame on this issue, and the West Midlands and the areas of the country are also starting to kind of the reins and see if they can negotiate devolution deal issues. But the specifics in terms of the budget announcements are the ones that Leeds and Sheffield and Liverpool. And in that budget announcement also, there were further powers devolved to Greater Manchester consistent with the framework that's been in place for a number of months now in Greater Manchester. And just bears out that point again, that this is a developmental emerging process. It's not a one kind of date that you suddenly get everything. It just doesn't work. It's worth just referencing the Cornwall example, because there's been some press coverage on this, Chair, in terms of announcements a week or so after the budget announcements in July, that Cornwall secured a devolution deal. Whilst factually that is true, it doesn't have a Devo, short-term Devo Max deal. So it's got some arrangements in terms of some aspects of devolution, but they haven't got a Devo Max and therefore have not proceeded to set of arrangements for that. It's just worth referencing that as a counterbalance to the rest of the conversation I'm going to have this morning on this issue. And just to reference also the comprehensive spending review, which we think will emerge in November, probably early December actually, in terms of the outcome of the government's own budget process for its own department's expenditure. Mirrors the local government kind of budget processes that we all follow individually. You can imagine how complex that is for government itself to be able to manage its own kind of budget allocations and to see through its commitments about trying to save 40% on most items of government expenditure, with some degree of protected services, education is the obvious one to bear in mind, probably health as well, whereas everything else pretty much is not protected. So the details of that is going to be worked through in the autumn by government itself, and they will announce the outcome of that there. Says end of November, but I would anticipate more realistically early December on that kind of issue. And formally, they have sought for RIPRAP representations to be made to them by the 4th of September to consider the impact of spending issues and government departmental spending issues. So the submission that we're trying to put together now for the 4th of September through the combined authority arrangement here around devolution and the potential of the devolution deal actually formally roots itself into the comprehensive spending review. And so that's the kind of channel that it goes through in order to provide a framework for negotiations and dialogue, which would be ongoing through the autumn between ourselves if we proceed down this track over the entire autumn period on a range of different themes and subjects and topics, which I'll just briefly reference in a second. So I think in terms of where we are in the city region, what I think we're all signed up to and agreed on is welcoming the opportunity to try to secure much more devolution to the local city region for democracy to have much more direct benefit and direct say and influence over lots of other forms of government spend outside of local government that are currently obviously decided in Whitehall and Westminster. That, in a very high-level sense, is clearly what we're trying to negotiate and achieve to secure much more devolution, much more local consideration, much more local determination and influence over a range of government spend that happens already in the city region, so that you can actually exercise much more influence over the impact of that and the outcomes of it. And I would suggest the prioritisation of areas of spend is contextual point around the local city region growth plan and transport for the north and indeed the northern powerhouse, all that kind of stuff. I wasn't going to go into detail, I'm sure, but I'm more than happy to answer any questions or conversations about that. Should I be able to? It's important to emphasise that the sub bullet points there about what we're trying to achieve in terms of objectives or principles around this. The whole point of devolution from the government's point of view is about trying to make existing money go further, certainly improve productivity, but also to try to secure accelerated growth, the rebalancing of public-private, rebalancing of north and south, all those existing government policies also have a bearing on the devolution conversation. We're very keen, obviously, to get localised service design and influence in the way that I touched on a minute ago, but also to try to apply some of the things that we have successfully dealt with in terms of coming to terms with reduced expenditure while still maintaining quality services in that area of public sector reform and engaging with government departments, particularly kind of senior official civil service level rather than ministerial level, around how some of these things can actually be done better by working for collectively and by having a more localised focus over those kind of areas of activity. And obviously the thing about us together around this beyond making existing money go further is that between ourselves and government we should be looking to achieve much greater and better outcomes for people, for our residents and citizens, and specifically because health is one of those areas that I'm referencing a bit, about better health outcomes and well-being for local residents, and health I think in itself is a good example, a very complex example, but a very good example of where I think we would all want to see better health outcomes for all of our citizens and residents than the existing system is able to provide. And I recognise there's a lot of complexity in that statement, but so I've developed that particularly this one. And having locally developed and delivered solutions working better than what I refer to as the one size fits all, which is clearly been the national system up to this particular point, and which we all got frustrated with one time or another, whether politically, democratically, or as civil service official level. And so formally then to reference that if we engage down this process, we will be submitting a proposition to the CSR considerations on the 4th of September. There's been a number of conversations with civil servants around the context for that submission, and there will be further conversations obviously between now and the 4th of September and consider the proposition. Let me just take a step out, Chair, to emphasise this particular point. The whole point of the exercise around any devolution deal that we engage with around is around devolving from government to the city region. It is not the opposite, i.e. it is not a question of changing the existing sovereignty, I use that word Whitehall, Westminster, into the city region, where through the combined authority, through whatever the government system emerges over the next few months and the next period of time, that you have more local say over those kind of activities, those kind of budgets, and the outcomes that we're looking for from it. So I won't go through the detail of these, Chair, for obvious reasons, partly because it would take a huge amount of time, and because we're frankly not yet in a position where we can answer intelligently obvious questions that you and others would have around all of the individual controlling parts of this. So this is the set of themes that we're looking to engage in a dialogue with government around from the 4th of September through to the outcome of the comprehensive spending review that the Chancellor announces his autumn statement. And I would suggest well beyond that date, the Manchester parallel that I've used a couple of times definitely applies, where that I suspect there will be some things that are agreed and agreeable, some things that are in principle and agreements associated with them, and the others where much more extensive dialogue and discussion and debate will take place over that period of time. So I'm more than happy to go through any of these, Chair, if you see what's a bit more example, a little bit more clarification. But most of these are around very, very high level kind of frameworks and themes to be discussed and debated, and then see what we can negotiate over that period of time between September, as I say, the autumn statement, and as I say, in some cases, help them. If we were to explore help, as it suggests, health and social care arrangements, and trying to create a better system in terms of the governance organisation or combination of both, like Manchester have been exploring as well, that will take a huge amount of time. It will not be agreed on the 5th of September. It will not be agreed, I would suggest, even in early December when the Chancellor makes his big autumn statement announcements. But the dialogue will be in place, and the dialogue will continue, and will be hopefully some outcomes arising from that dialogue over a period of time. And I think all the good ones, give or take, will follow the same kind of set of arrangements. So they're there for kind of reference and for any questions that the members might have this morning. We're recognising we're going to increasingly travel more detail into these kind of issues over the next few months, not just over the next week. It's trying to emphasise that point, Chair. So next steps, if I may, obviously the core themes, welcome any feedback that by the folks have got this morning around those kind of issues, whether there's any gaps, whether there's anything that you want to clarify, whether there's any things that you think we ought to add in at this particular point. Bearing in mind what I've tried to probably overstate, which is that this is a dialogue that we're only just beginning, it's not an outcome in its own right, it's not down to level of projects, it's not down to level of money, or any of those kind of things. They're well down the track on this conversation. It's the start of a process in many respects. Just in terms of practicalities and domestic arrangements, we're seeking additional meeting, especially with the combined authority on the 2nd of September, for you to consider further detail around that framework that I've presented to you briefly this morning. And at that point, obviously, we'll be asking for your agreement to send in a submission off in whatever form we can get it to in accordance with the 4th of September deadline. So that's the operative domestic kind of practical thing that we'll do to agree going forward in terms of the process. And then obviously beyond this particular conversation, certainly beyond the 4th of September deadline for the submission, we know that we've got to do an awful lot more engagement with stakeholders, with partner organisations, with private sector partners and others across the city region, and also within each authority, because I'm very conscious, that's because the chief executive is involved, but most of our own elected members don't have any detail, we have this kind of stuff, because the detail isn't there, is the reality of it. So all of that kind of set of conversations and dialogue is going to be very, very important going forward, and will take a huge amount of time and efforts and energy over the autumn period. So again, just to emphasise the point, we're opening the dialogue on the 4th of September, so guess if we get to that point, he will say that he's agreed certain things and had certain things being developed. That's similar to what's happened in the Manchester example. I think that would take a bit.
Just specifically, Chair, the recommendations of those that are on the papers before you. More than happy to answer any questions or take any comments about the help of this particular one.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Chair. Okay, members, comments, questions, contributions?
Directors, to the absolutely clear to every thought about there is a long way to go. Process and the bottom line is the if you walk out the team you can see here, the detail in all of those teams has been negotiated. They are just, if you like, teams, that's it, that's what it says on the tip. But the negotiations and discussions will take place on the back of that actually right. It's not necessarily just what it says. And the bottom line is all of those deals, if you like, will be agreed by all the public policies. And in regards to the comments about the sovereignty, if you like, which is contained on the authority, the constitution, or any arrangement is not exist in the main conditions with all the constituencies that make the system at a juncture, at a time.
Robert.
Yeah, first of all, thank you, Jeff, for that very interesting presentation. This has been one of those issues before this region because of time to find the future for many years to come. I think also it's world forces is very important. We are in this scandal on those participants in this next round in Manchester. I say that because I think capacity becomes an issue we've got to deal with many more adverts. Secondly, applying for advantage is critical in that context. We must be leading the way, be compact on simply falling behind. It's also, of course, the fact that we know better in the city region what counts. Our knowledge is superior, and therefore the things that we're identifying as being the people will benefit our people and our businesses. I think in terms of the themes, as Stuart has said, they are just that. I do believe where they're just coming from a left point of view, we totally endorse the direction. Like the sector generally overwhelmingly supports this movement for the devolution. The price has to be correct, but there's a concept, they want to see this happen. They probably don't necessarily understand all the intricacies and niceties of the procedures and sensitivities around it, but as a concept, they just think this is something which is needed to take us forward to the next stage. I think around those themes, and this is reflected there, productivity, growth, jobs, and skills are the heart of it really in many ways. And very pleased to see those reflected so clearly. So, very pleased to recognise this is one stage of quite a long passage. The left is behind it, wants to engage closely in those sort of sectors in the business dimension.
Yeah, Frank.
Just a very quick question, Chair. Jeff, are you confident that we're up to speed when you compare other city regions who are going through this process? I'll tell you what Joe says himself about this being a long process. What in comparison to the likes of the West Midlands, Leeds, Sheffield and so on, how far down the road are they in comparison to us? Because you mentioned the benefits of being an early adopter. I think that's an important point to know.
Good question. There's no kind of lead table on this issue, you might imagine, but it's quite scary, quite genuine feedback we're getting from the civil servants involved in many of the regions and some of the areas that we've referenced, saying that we're actually further advanced than anybody else in that frame. And I do find that quite scary. But each of them's got their own complexities, so it's difficult to be able to realistically assess. I am that we will do our best as officials to bring to you on the 2nd of September the best that we can do in terms of landing position around those things that we've identified that gives us the best possible fighting chance through the autumn to get the best possible deal we can. But this is a region for its businesses and its residents because that's what we want to achieve. And we'll clearly get better feel for that as well.
Okay.
Yeah,
Joe.
I just want to make one comment really, and that's a little basically to anybody from who's listed in or public. The only way I believe the city meeting should engage in this process and start the deal or conclude the deal with government is if we are convinced that this helps us accelerate growth, create more businesses, create more jobs, help us become a sustainable city region. By that I mean, you know, in terms of more resilient, more able to look after ourselves, more able to generate new funds and new money to pay for the services that we need. That's what this is about for me. It isn't something that is wholly desirable in the sense of leading it. It is actually to actually help us develop and help us grow our economy to create jobs and businesses. It is, for me, a deal. It is an ask of us, it's for us to make sure that we get that right. That's why it's important to remember that. Remember that it is a process, but the final decision will be made by the city deans and leaders on whether we believe, whether we actually believe that it will make a real difference to the economy of the city region. And that, you know, includes when we talk about growth within those things, we talk about how we you know, support business and business growth. That means also looking at ways of how we create the skills and the needs of businesses within the area. So it's not just about investments and infrastructure investments and opportunities for growth in that sense. It's about how we respond to the needs of businesses as well. And then it's the infrastructure stuff that, as I said, health and social care. These are the real game changers that we can actually use to our advantage to make that big difference. And that's the prize at the end of this. And of course, with any prize, you have to pay a price. And that means that will make it to change the way you do things. But it is too important to use this opportunity.
Okay, any other points, colleagues, that anybody wants to raise? Right, well, you've got the recommendations in front of you, which is to, first of all, note the emerging themes which Jed described to form the basis of our input to the forthcoming comprehensive spend review, and secondly, agree that the city region's final input will be considered by this body at a special meeting now on the 2nd of September. So that's the recommendations for this morning. Are we content to agree those recommendations? They agreed? Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, Jeff. Yeah. Okay, that takes us on to item 5, European issues, sustainable urban development strategy. And Mike Palin will take us through this. Please, Mike.
Thank you, Chair. The paper before you outlines the city region's approach to the development of a SUD strategy for the city region area. SUD stands for Sustainable Urban Development, and national government requires that 5% of European funding be allocated against these strategies. So the government asked the city region to develop a strategy for spending what will, in our case, be around £8.5 million. The paper outlines our approach, and the recommendations A and B seek members' agreement to continue the development of our strategy and for officers to submit the strategy by the deadline date of September 25th. Importantly, and particularly given the conversations around devolution, there is a bit of extra flexibility in spending of this money if you agree to be something called an urban authority. So we're seeking permission from the combined authority to be an urban authority, the CA to be an urban authority, and we'll put the appropriate management structures in place. happy to take any questions. I'd just like to add, as a demonstration of the joint work that does go on in the city region, I'd like to thank the offices of Liverpool City Council and the LEP and Merseytravel, who've been working on this strategy for quite a bit of time. It's been well received, and just to thank them for their inputs on this process.
Okay, thanks, Mike. Any comments or questions on this paper? No? Okay, if not, can we agree the recommendations in section 2? They agreed? Thank you very much. Item 6 is the Skills Capital Investment Fund update. This is in the latest in a series of reports around this fund. And John Corrish, you're here just to take us through this, please, John.
Thank you, Chair. As members will recall, the Skills Capital Investment Fund was part of the City Region's wider growth field. And it's been delivered over 4 strands of programme activity. Strand 1, sites and premises, and strand 2, improved facilities investment packages were agreed by the combined authority at the June and July 2015 meetings, respectively. Today's report is we've got a dual focus, seeking approval for the recommended investment package for applications received under strand 3, which is equipment, and also to endorse the business case for the low carbon strand, which is strand 4, which has been led by the low carbon team at the LEP, and also to delegate authority to officers to work up the commissioning arrangements for the strand so that we can get that underway. So on the strand 3 equipment, we received 9 applications in total, and in appendix 1 you'll see a summary of the projects and the recommended grant values. The assessment process followed more of a business case than strand 1, and that was in reflecting the levels of investment involved and also the nature of the works as well. Pleased to report overall the applications were well aligned to city region's growth sectors, and the total investment package that's been recommended for approval today is 1.265 million. So that's the equipment strand. On the low carbon, as noted, it's the LEP's low carbon team that have led on this and developed the business case with colleagues in the city region, and that's attached at appendix 2 for approval. Really the aim of that strand is to improve energy efficiency within further education facilities and reduce money costs and also environmental costs. We've consulted with the Merseyside College Association on the strand and on the business case, and they're positive about the potential savings that could be incurred from the investment if that was to take place. So by approving the business case today, we'll enable the scheme to progress and best ensure that we can commit funds in year, which is 15-16. Recommendations are on page 19, and happy to take any questions if there are any.
Thanks, John. Okay. Any questions, members, on this report? No? Okay, if not, anyone want to ask a name?
Joe? I just want to return to the negative comment, really. It's probably the most difficult because of the level of life. To say it's about breakfast is difficult because of the man, yeah, sorry, but that's the way I feel about it. You know, for me, I just think that it's, you know, I'm looking at the sort of outputs on it, and I'm looking at that money that we just immediately had to, if you like, offer to organisations within the city, these are the ones that we're doing, that's listed there. I just felt that if you like, rushed into that. And I accept the reasons why, not critical of it, but I just think that sometimes just to, if you like, this is because of the evolution agenda as well, it's a particularly important issue to us. And I just think that we need to spend some time here looking at how this is planned in the future, and how it's going to work from school. Because I just think it's, I don't know, I just think it's if you like, chasing something of the industry, maybe.
Yeah, Barry. Barry.
Thanks. Just in the back of Joe's point, I think it comes back to the conversation we've had
external capacity. And just ask you, going on, are you confident that you think there's enough capacity in the system to deal with these funds and get through?
Yeah, take the point on board completely. If I can refer to Mike Palin, that's in more detail.
I think there's a recognition, and it relates as well to devolution, as the Mayor touched upon, that as a city region, as we get more of this funding, it's our responsibility to allocate it. We actually do need the right capacity in place to be able to actually manage processes as best we can. And today we have, to a certain extent, been asking people to do this as a tag on to the day job. And I think we recognise that point as a group of chief executives going forward. We're happy to take away and actually understand how we better manage these processes and actually have the right capacity in place to do these things.
I accept that, and all three parties have intervention in that regard. And if that's the point, then that needs to be said. You know, and I'm glad that you've said it now, because we can no longer send all back. But what you reminds me of the old days of the European grants, we just used to chase it because it was there. And you know, we've got, this is a huge task ahead of us to actually fit training and skills and development. We've got to get it right. It's important that we do, and I don't think that we can just, you know, only out there being doled out, if you like, without any real outcomes. And it means that we have to use extra funds or whatever we get that fund capacity to make sure we get it right. Then we've got to get it right. Let's draw the line on this, but let's try and, you know, do it better and get ahead of the game.
Okay. Other points. I think that is an important point, and I think there's a much bigger point, isn't there, about, you know, the devolution agenda will require us to have the capacity to deliver additional functions and responsibilities, and that is a key issue that needs to be sort of factored into the discussions with civil servants and government going forward, because, you know, there's no good us getting loads of powers and new responsibilities if we haven't got the ability to deliver them. So I think that is an absolutely fundamental issue that I'm sure the officers involved in the discussions with the civil servants will kind of take away. Yeah, okay. So with those sort of caveats, if you like, and some further reflection, can we agree the recommendations in section 2 on this report? I agree. Okay, thank you. Okay, so that then takes us to various minutes, which I just want need you to go through. So item 7 are the minutes of the Merseytravel Committee meeting held on the 25th of June. Can we confirm those minutes? Are they agreed? Thank you. Item 8 are the minutes of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit Committee held on the 12th of May. Can we confirm those minutes? Thank you. And then finally, item 9, the minutes of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Scrutiny Panel held on the 8th of July. Can we confirm those minutes? They agreed? Okay. No other business. Not been informed of any other urgent items. So it just remains for me to thank everybody for their attendance and contribution to this meeting, and to remind you that the next meeting of Combined Authority is a special meeting on the Wednesday, the 2nd of September at 9 a.m. start. So please, can people make a note of that? I look forward to seeing you then. Declare the meeting closed. Thank you.